this page is interesting not only because of the coupons, but this page is also interesting because it very nicely shows that in professional schematic you would like to include also some symbols which are not really components, but for example you would like to have them in the BOM, bill of material, because you don't want to forget them to buy, or you need to include them when this board is built. If you have a look down here, you can see label, okay, or battery, platform controller heatsink. So based on these numbers, the people who are building this board, they are able to buy all the components which are really needed to actually build the board. And these are not only the electrical components. Up here you can see these are processor sockets. I was just curious, so I searched for these specific components in the BOM, bill of material. So if you have a look there, these are the components, and these are the exact part numbers. And when you search for them, you can see this is the right side of the socket for the processor, and this is the left side of the socket for the processor. So in professional schematic, you really would like to include also the components which are not really electrical components, but also the items which you need to really, really build the board. Everything what you need to build the board, including things like labels or heatsinks. On the next page, there are mounting holes, and this is another really good example of the kind of symbol what you would like to include in the schematic. This is different kind of component. Yeah, these symbols which are here, we would like to have them in the BOM, but they are not really used in the PCB. This one is used in the PCB, but it's not really used in the BOM. But again, you would like to include it in the schematic because you would like to, you don't want to forget about the mounting holes. And also these mounting holes, you can see they are electrically connected. They are connected to the ground. So the proper way to place the mounting holes is a great mechanical symbol and special footprint for them. Next page, I2C headers, not really interesting page. And I think on these pages, these are going to be about the powers. So I'm going on the next page, some capacitors, MOSFET, CPU filter, and this is interesting. This is how they create the 90 amps. I would like to see how they do it. What kind of components they use to create the 90 amps for the processor. So let's have a closer look. Power rail PVCC in CPU 0. The controller is this chip, TPS 53679. 1.8 volt, 99 amps, maximum 255 amps, and that's it. So this is just a controller, okay? If you have a look on datasheet of this chip, you can search for it. It's just multiphase controller. You need additional components, you need the transistors to be able to generate the voltages. And the transistors, they are on the next page, I think. Okay, here are the transistors. Or they are not really transistors, they are a little bit special components. I think they are on next three pages, like 1, 2, 3. And again, if you search for this component, this is what you will find. Synchronous back necks FET. This product integrates the driver IC and power MOSFETs. 70 amps continuous operating current. Wow. Yeah. So to be able to generate the 90 amps, the power rail with the 90 amps for the processor, you need the controller, which is here, and you will need these other special transistors, which are here. Are they all generating same voltage? Yes, I think they are all generating just the PVCC in CPU 0. On the next pages, there are some decoupling capacitors for the processor. Notice the nodes. Notice the nodes. Again, many people, they don't include nodes in their schematics. The nodes are very important. Yeah? You can use them, for example, say where exactly the components need to be placed. On the next page, there is something not really interesting, blank page. And there are some other power supplies, because there are a number of power supplies, but none of them is so huge like the first one for the processor. So this one is just 14 amps, maximum 21 amps. Again, there is a controller and some MOSFET decoupling filter and another chip. I think this is for memories. PVDDQ, 64 amps, max 70, 1 amp. Again, same thing, controller and MOSFETs, decoupling, MOSFET, decoupling, PVTT, decoupling, filter, another regulator, I think for the memories. And the next power supplies are for the CPU one. Let's have a look on the layout. Let's have a look how they routed these powers in the board. When we go to PCB layout, there are a couple of things what I would like to show you what are really interesting. So, probably the most interesting power planes will be the 90 amp power planes, and they are down here. So, this is the big power supply, and this is the big power plane, the PVCC in CPU 0 power plane, which is connected between the power supply and the processor. Notice there are no thermal reliefs on these pins. Interesting. And notice that this power plane, because there is so huge current, it's not only routed on the top layer, it is also routed on layer 3, see? It is also routed on layer 4, here it is. It is also routed on layer 6, here it is. And it is also routed on the bottom layer. So it is routed on multiple layers because of the very high currents. Notice the number of vias, okay? How many are here? What we also always have a look at decoupling capacitors. So when I zoom in, you will see the decoupling capacitors. They are placed in the middle of the socket on the top layer, and they are also placed in the middle of the socket on the bottom layer. Again, no decoupling capacitors around the socket. And when I mention these thermal reliefs, no thermal reliefs here on these pins, I was very surprised that they use the thermal reliefs on this platform controller hub, because I never use thermal reliefs to connect these power planes. I always connect it directly. So this was something very unusual, and this is what I normally use, the direct connection of the power plane to the power pins. Now we are going to have a look at the memory power planes. Very interesting. I will enable this layer 2, the nice solid ground plane, and watch. I'm really curious if you can see it. Can you see it? Very nice ground everywhere. The blue color is ground, okay? Except this area down here under the memory slots. Wow! Here are some other power planes. What is this? If you have a look, when I click on this power plane, it's a PVDDQ for ABC slot. This is power for DEF memory slot. When I enable this layer 7, so I will disable this one, I will enable layer 7 ground plane. It's same. Very nice solid ground plane and the powers here. That's not all. This is going to be even more confusing if you are not sure what's going on. I'm going to enable this layer 5, which is normally used for all the kind of power planes. Have a look. Don't forget, blue color is ground. What? So everywhere here there are power planes, except the area under the memory slots. There is ground everywhere. Sorry. So why did I just don't place this ground plane on this layer 7? And the power planes from this layer 7, why they don't place them on the layer 5? Do you know why? To understand why this ground plane and power plane in DDR4 memory area are designed the way as we can see them in this server board layout, go to Google and search for this document. Find TN4040 DDR4.2.0 design guide. It's a very good document. And we will jump on page number 19, and this is going to help us to understand what's going on. So, when you are doing DDR4 memory layout, sharing a single plane for both power and ground does not provide strong signal referencing. When you are doing DDR4 memory layout, designs should reference database signals to VSS, to ground plane, so reference database signals to ground plane, and command control address bus and clock should reference VDD power plane. That's exactly what we can see on the server board. And we will go back to the board. I just would like to show you two more things in this document, because many people ask about this. So I will go a little bit up. And many people ask how they should decide on the tolerance which they should use for specific interface length matching. Yeah, so they are doing length matching of, I don't know, their specific interface, and they don't know if they should use tolerance 10 mils or 40 mils or, I don't know, 100 mils. They would like to understand how to calculate it. So this can give you an idea how you can maybe calculate this tolerance for your specific interface. First, you need to decide on how much of timing budget to allocate to routing mismatch. For example, in this case, they use 1%. So if you are not sure, you can use 1%. And at 800 megahertz clock, it means 6.25 picosecond. Now, typical flight times for FR4 PCB are near 6 picosecond per millimeter. And based on this number, and based on this number, you can very nicely calculate and understand that matching to plus minus 1 millimeter or plus minus 40 mils allocates 1% of the clock period to route matching. Okay? The other thing what many people here for data bus, you can use, for example, plus minus 0.5 millimeter, okay? Plus minus 20 mils. The second thing what I would like to mention here, many people, they are very surprised that propagation delay for inner layers and outer layers is different. So the signal travels different speed inside of the PCB than on top and bottom layers. Here you can read a little bit more about it. But this is interesting, okay? So what kind of tolerance you can, or you know, what kind of, what are the numbers, what are the differences? Here you can very nicely see that for the design of JEDEC UDIMMs, a 10% difference accounts for the differences in propagation of the inner layers versus the outer layers. So this can give you an idea about these propagation delays on inner and outer layers. So if you like, read this, okay? If you are interested about this topic. And there are more interesting stuff in this document. For example, power vias and sharing for DDR4 memories and decoupling. Yeah, I really recommend you to go through this document, and it also helps you to understand how these memories, how they work. Let's go back to the layout, and we are going to have a look if what we just learned, if that's exactly what we can see here on this board. And first, I would like to check the stack up, because, you know, in our case, we are going to have a look at the DDR4 signals, which are routed on layer 6. And in this case, the reference plane will be on layer 5 or end on layer 7, depends how you do the layout. But for example, when you are counting or when you are calculating impedance for layer 6, you will use usually as the reference planes, you will usually use also layer 5 and also layer 7. But there is, there is difference where or on which of these two layers, layer 5 or layer 7, where we place these important reference planes, the ground plane and the power reference plane for these DDR4 memory signals. Ideally, we would like to place these two reference planes on the layer which is closer to this layer 6. So if we have a look on the stack up, I will click on this button which is here. This is this stack up. Which of these layers is closer to layer 6? Layer 5 or layer 7? Layer 5 is almost 20 mils from layer 6. Layer 7 is just 4 mils from layer 6. So we would like to place the ground reference plane and the power reference plane on layer 7. Here in this board, you can see I enabled layer 6 and layer 7 because we are going to check these two layers. When I zoom in, you can also see I applied yellow color on all address command control signals. So these are the signals like ODT or chip select or, you know, address signals. And between these address command control signals, here in the middle, they are the clocks routed. And all these address command control signals and these clocks, they are routed above this big plane which is here, and that's the power plane. So, exactly as explained in the document, you can see in this layout that all the address command control signals and the clock signals are using this power plane as the reference plane. And when I zoom out, you can see all the other signals, these other data signals which are routed here and also here, they are routed about the ground plane. So they are using this ground plane as the reference plane. Exactly as in the document. Now you understand why it is done this way. And when we are speaking about this memory layout, I really would like to see how they routed DDR4 data signals. You remember when we were speaking about this memory layout, which is up here, DDR3 memory layout between this baseboard management controller and this memory chip, which is here. I told you this is not exactly the way how I normally route a memory interface, because in this case, for example, they routed some of the signals from same data bank, they routing them on two different layers. And also, if you remember, I told you usually I use a bigger gap between different data groups. If we go down here, this is something completely different. This is something how I usually do memory layout. So again, I use this green color to mark all the signals from same data group, from same data bank. And you can very nicely see all of these signals. They are all routed same way. They are all routed on same layers. You can also very nicely see this bigger gap between the different data groups. So this is exactly the way how I route memory signals, how I do the memory layout. What is maybe a little unusual on this memory layout is that here are two differential pairs inside of this group. And I'm going to explain a little bit about this, because maybe for some people this can be something new. Very often you only have one differential pair signal in data bank group, so this is something a little bit special. So let's have a look why here are two differential pairs. Very quickly and very simply, just to give you an idea what is this second differential pair about. I'm sure you know there are different kind of memory chips. For example, there are X16 memory chips, and you can connect 16 data lines to this one memory chip. Or there are also X8 memory chips, where you can connect 8 data lines to one memory chip. That's what you can see here. Yeah? And usually, in these cases, you need 8 data lines. You need DQS signals and DQM signals. But there are also X4 memory chips. That's what you can see here. You can connect 4 data lines to these memory chips, and you need DQS signal. So basically, for if you would like to connect 8 data lines, in this case, you need 2 DQS signals. This is a little bit different view on this kind of problematic. I need to say this is about DDR3 memory interface, but it's fine. This is also about DDR3 interface, but again, it's the same. Basically, typical DDR3 X4 based datasheet shows the DQS9 associated with DQ4, DQ5, DQ6, and DQ7 data lines. Yeah? DQS9. If we go into our layout and if I have a look, this is DQS0 and this is DQS9. So that's why we have this. I don't have datasheet from this processor, but I guess that's why we have the second differential pair here, because it's to give the support for these X4 devices when you use memory modules with X4 devices. There is something really interesting about this kind of memory interface when you are routing this kind of interface with different kind of memory device support. Especially when you are doing bit swapping, you need to be careful, okay? There are some, normally or very often, when you are doing a memory interface, you can do a bit swapping within one byte. So you can swap the bits any way you want. But if you would like to support this kind of interface, or if you would like to support the error check on the memory interface, you may need to be careful, because then there may be some limitations and you only can swap the bits within nibble. They call it nibble, within 4 bits. If you like, just search for all these documents. You can see the names of the documents here, and you can read more information about this. This one is from the JEDEC website, so you need to register here. It's free and you can download this kind of document. Or you can just Google, for example, for, again, DDR4 design guide. This is one of the documents which you will find about. It's from NXP, and it's, again, interesting document. And here you can see the notes about the bit swapping. So byte swap is allowed in any order that would best fit the customer's design. No specific byte ordering is enforced or required, but bit swap is only allowed within a nibble, so 4 bits. Bit swap across 2 nibbles is not allowed. Bit swap across byte lines is not allowed. So, you know, there are different kind of rules which can give you the idea of what you need to be careful about when you are routing DDR3 or DDR4 interfaces. Let's go back to the server board, and there is one more thing what I would like to point out in this DDR4 memory layout, and it's this unusual layout under the processor, unusual routing. If we open the special cadence document, here you will find more information about this kind of routing. Yeah, it's called tab routing. And I can tell you, I have never used it, but it has some benefits, so you can read it here. Impedance control in pin field breakout region, manage crosstalk in open field region, allows for longer trace lengths and more compressed routing. So next time when you see something like this, you will know it's called tapped routing.